the Lord. Welcome those also who are on live stream with us. We don't underplay the value of fellowship in Christ. It, of course, is best to be preferred when we are in each other's immediate presence, but I'm very grateful that God has permitted us to meet together in a live sort of way with people at a distance from us. Amen. Tonight we're going to be in the fourth chapter of John. This will be our 52nd exposition in this book. We're still dealing with the incident of the woman meeting the well, a man meeting the Jesus meeting the woman at the well of Samaria. Now, when it comes to God influencing people and leading them, He does this in a variety of ways, and some of them are illustrated in this text we have. The faintest voice that can be heard is the voice of creation. It's speaking, but it's very, it's not loud, it's very toned down. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night uttereth knowledge. That's the psalmist's comment on creation. So it's like lisping to humanity. And then it's making known the power and Godhead of the Lord. That is His capabilities and His deity or self-existence. Then there's their conscience. God works with that. The conscience can accuse and excuse. It's a little louder voice, but it's still rather faint. It's largely intuitive from within. I mean, you don't take courses about the conscience. Everybody's got one. And then on a slightly higher level, the law is a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. So it has its testimony it gives. And then there's also individuals that are noted for their identity with God. There's those kind of people, like the Jews in their synagogues in this day here. There's also the godly reasoning that some people will use, as in Paul really reasoned with Felix about righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come. There's this, we're talking about how God brings people to Himself, the different ways. And there's also the light that emits from those in whom the Lord dwells. Without them ever speaking a word, there's an influence that emits from them. In other words, there's never been a person that has ever lived that has not been exposed to enough to provoke a quest for God. So people have to be careful about talking about. Some people have never heard. You have to know what you're talking about. There's no such thing as an offspring of Adam who has not been given multiple testimonies within and without about God, enough to provoke a quest. The fact that they didn't doesn't even bear on the subject. The fact that men didn't take advantage of this doesn't mean that the testimony of nature was inadequate. It was adequate.
Amen.
Yes.
In the according to Romans there, the question wasn't whether or not they heard, but whether they sought after God.
That's right.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
That would have been because they were surrounded by evidence. Now, back behind all of this, of course, God is drawing men. The Holy Spirit's convicting men. Lord Jesus is teaching men. So that's behind all of these, in the background of all of these things. No reason we read statements. There's no wonder we read statements such as salvation is of the Lord's.
Yes.
Or for of him and to him and through him are all things, to him be glory forever and ever. Salvation unto our God. See, that's why we read things like this. Were it not for divine activity, Satan would stifle every human gospel initiative.
Yeah, right.
He would stifle it were it not for divine activity.
Amen.
That's how when anyone comes to the Lord, it's not so a person can rack them up.
Yes.
That's a testimony to God working.
Yeah.
And God is to be praised when anybody turns to the Lord or anybody is revived Godward. God is to be praised.
Praise God.
All right, here's our text for tonight. John 4:39-42. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the woman, which testified, he told me all that ever I did. So when the Samaritans were come to him, they besought him that he would tarry with them. And he abode there 2 days. And many more believed because of his own word. And said unto the woman, now we believe, not because of thy saying, for we have heard him ourselves, and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world.
Amen.
What a statement. Many of the Samaritans believed. All right, let's remember that the Samaritans of that time had not been exposed to any preaching and teaching by anybody that knew Jesus. As a matter of fact, they'd never been exposed to the preaching of Jesus. There's no record that any Samaritans went to hear John, and John didn't go to Samaria. John the Baptist, and he didn't go to Samaria. There's no record of Jesus preaching in Samaria prior to this, or of any Samaritans going to hear him. And there's a record about all the people, multitudes came out to hear Jesus, but Samaria is never mentioned in all
it's
of those.
It's also among the Jews, the ones that did go to hear Jesus, they weren't likely to have gone and shared that with the Samaritans.
That's right.
Like you'd think, well, it's kind of in the area, surely they'd have heard, but the Jews avoided the Samaritans.
That's right, that's right. Now, they believed on Jesus because of a saying. They believed because of a saying. Now, this is in the Bible, so we do well to accept it. We understand this was not believing under the saving of the soul. They believed because of a saying. And the saying was this, and this probably is a summary, but I'm not sure it was just a summary. He told me all things that ever I did. That's what she is recorded. She told him. And that's a saying.
Yeah.
That's not a dissertation. It's a saying.
Mm-hmm.
It's a word. They believed. We'll go into it, but you can't account for that by her eloquence. And it certainly wasn't because of her character. They believed because of her saying.
Amen.
You might be surprised what God can use.
Yes, amen.
Now I maintain that the words that this woman spoke did not have enough power of themselves to persuade anyone to believe.
Uh-huh.
It was the activity of the Holy Spirit that worked through those words. They apparently reasoned that if this man told her he knew everything about her, he probably knows everything about us too. Now let's look at the nature of her testimony for a moment. She did not tell anyone the result of what Jesus had said. Huh? She didn't say, I was this and now I'm that. That's not what she said. She didn't account for any change of life, although doubtless one here, but that's not the thing that had the power. Oh, this is something to see. He told me all things that ever I did. A powerful and effective testimony isn't telling people what you used to be and what you are now. Understand that. This is not a potent testimony. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying don't expect big results from this. The testimony is to be what God has done.
That's right. Amen.
Not what you're doing.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Or what you have done. It's what God has done. He told me.
Yes.
That's a testimony.
That's right.
He told me. All things that I did. That's a testimony. Now, if a person did not have a shaded background, talking about how they live would not make a lot of impression on the. If a person had been conscientiously living for God, unless he explained what happened, it wouldn't make an impression on people that they changed. That's why Paul said, I was a persecutor. See, nobody would have, no one doubted that Paul was serious about God.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not like this woman here. I'm pointing out, not like this woman here. No one doubted that he was really living for God. No one doubted that. But this woman wasn't, and everybody knew it. And yet, that's not what she accented.
Right.
It's just interesting. Uh-huh. A powerful testimony is particularly declaring what God has done, and then your life has to support what you say was done.
Yes.
Yes, Sister Barb. That's right.
Uh-huh. He was going to do. Amen.
Amen.
You
must know that there are a lot of people talking about how they love God, but there's no real evidence that they do. If they don't tell you, you'd never guessed it.
Yes.
They didn't say they loved Jesus. Those words didn't come out of their mouth.
Uh-huh.
You would have never concluded that they did.
Something in you. It's not like you have to go home and memorize. Let me see. It gets us all straight. If God's really done something in you and you are aware of it, one, you will talk about it. But the Holy Spirit uses things that God does.
Yeah. I wouldn't doubt that maybe some of these people had talked to this woman about straightening up her life. I wouldn't doubt that maybe some of that happened. But my point here, I won't want to linger on it anymore, but the point is that it's what God has done.
That's right.
Turns people. When they heard Peter preach, they said he talked about the wonderful works of God. Peter didn't say, look, once we were ignorant, now we see. Huh? He didn't say, we didn't understand what Jesus said, but now we understand. That's not how he testified, even though that was true.
Yeah.
And we pick up on it. Once you're in Christ, you can kind of see this.
Yeah.
But he told them what God had done.
Amen.
That was the point. That's right. Now here is one of the first examples we have of someone believing that didn't see.
Mm-hmm.
Remember after Jesus rose from the dead? Thomas insisted he has some tangible evidence.
Yeah.
And Jesus never did bless him. He didn't say, blessed art thou, Thomas. He didn't say those words.
Yeah.
I don't think he did anyway. Somebody want to check the text just to make sure, but I don't think he said that. He said, blessed are they that see not.
Yeah.
All right, here we have a bona fide example of someone that didn't see,
uh-huh,
yet believed in the basis of a testimony of someone else.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Now, what does that tell you about the power and influence of the person of Christ? See, it's amazing what he can use. He used this testimony.
Yes.
which was kind of rudimentary to say the least, but he used that testimony because that was real.
Amen.
And he worked with it. This is the reason it's so important to preach the word.
Yes.
And declare the wonderful works of God.
Amen.
This is what God's going to use. He's not going to use some methodology.
Yes.
You are wasting your time if you try and figure out or buy into some method of winning souls.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
You've wasted your time and you have reproached Christ.
Yeah.
Jesus said, if I be lifted up, and he was speaking about his manner of death, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me. But it's got to be affirmed. Not declared as this is what we believe. That the gospel has to be affirmed by someone who themselves has embraced it.
Yes,
in this case,
yes.
Jesus told this woman what she had done, and she embraced it. She didn't fight against it. She didn't say, well, that's not fair. Mm-hmm. I mean, you don't know all the difficulties I had and how I've been abused and how men took advantage of me. See, she didn't say any of that.
That's right.
She accepted Christ's assessment of her condition.
You know, sometimes a person may feel like, well, but my testimony, he really hasn't done like mighty things like he did in it. But see, if it's real, if God really has done something, it's worthy of telling people.
That's right. See, it's not how much he's done.
Yes.
It's if he's done it. Uh-huh. I mean, if you were to compare feeding a multitude with a few fish and that doesn't rank as high as the resurrection of Christ from the dead. I mean, it's not up in that category, you see. But it does have power.
But whenever we talk about these things, we have to be careful of our standard of what's quantitative. Mm-hmm. Every person who has come to God through Christ has gone from death to life.
Life, that's right.
Now, what do you compare to that?
That's right.
Is that greater than parting a Red Sea?
That's right.
See, it's not like how impressive was this to the flesh of men?
Yeah.
It's like this is a great work. This is the great work of salvation because life implies so much. It's a very large thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To change the nature of a person is greater than a miraculous phenomenon in the natural order.
Yeah.
Now God does not work through things concocted by men. He uses his own, I hesitate to use the word methods, his own ways. He uses his own ways to accomplish his own purposes. If the routines and procedures won't work, if God was not working, nothing would work.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. If Jesus was not active, nothing would be successful pertaining to life and godliness. Matter of fact, if Jesus was not active, the world wouldn't hold its course. It'd spin out of order.
Yeah, that's right.
You'd go back to chaos. We might consider the presence of God, the ministry of Jesus, the ministry of the Holy Spirit, God's predetermined purpose. These are the things that make everything else pertaining to the kingdom work. To me, there's no way to account for many Samaritans believing on Jesus because of the saying of the woman, unless God's in the picture. You can't really account for that. None of us have ever heard of anything like this actually happening in our presence.
Yeah.
At least I haven't. I've never talked to anyone that's seen anything like this, either here in foreign countries, where somebody would give a testimony of a rather minor thing, and a lot of people believed because of it. I never have heard anything like this taking place. But it took place here.
Yeah.
Now, what I'm saying is that it's the God factor that made it take place. Now let's go into this a little further. When the Samaritans came to him, Now, Jesus apparently remained at the well where he met the woman. That was like the point of reference. See, so he made himself available. Think of it that way. He made himself available. There were some people now that could look for him but couldn't find him. Jesus said this one time, John 8:21, "Ye shall seek me and ye shall die in your sins. Whither I go, ye cannot come." See, so there's people like that. But these weren't people like that. If you found Christ, you did because he let you.
Amen.
And God led you.
Yes.
Praise God.
If Jesus didn't want you, you would have just veered off course. That's all. So you can find a lot of comfort just to the fact, just to the fact that you got in.
Yes.
You can derive a lot of comfort from that. These few words that these women said, God working with them, enabled them to overcome their entire system of religion.
Yes. Amen.
It overcame. See, they didn't know who they were worshiping. That's what Jesus told. You don't even know who you're worshiping. They overcame. That's a tremendous thing to overcome now.
Yeah,
some of us know about that. Ignorance is a hard thing to overcome, but this was overcome almost immediately because of God. See, if you work with the right material, the gospel of Christ and the wonderful works of God, if you work with the right material, responses don't have to be delayed.
Amen.
Things can happen on a more immediate basis. Now, Satan couldn't stop these. Do you think Satan wanted these people to get to Jesus? He's out there seeking whom he may devour.
Uh-huh.
I would think that Samaritans would be considered by Satan easily devourable.
Uh-huh.
He couldn't stop them. Don't think he didn't try.
Yeah.
Oh, don't think he didn't throw up some obstacles to make it inconvenient to go that day or... You ever think for maybe a rainstorm, do you name it? Trying to stop him, but he couldn't stop him from getting there. Those who, as John 12:21 said, some Greeks said, "We would see Jesus." Now, someone who honestly says that will not fail to find him.
Amen.
He will not.
Mm-hmm.
We would see Jesus, and they did.
Even David said to Solomon, "If you seek the Lord with your whole heart, you'll find him."
You'll find him.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
right. The holy angels back behind the scenes, holy angels are sent to minister to those who shall be heirs of salvation.
Amen.
They're not in there yet. They're not in that category yet. But the holy angels are going to ensure that those who shall inherit salvation get to that point.
Amen.
So the holy angels are like accompanying this band of people as they leave the city. There's a lot of people. Remember, Jesus saw them coming. He saw, look at that harvest out there. See, he was surrounded, no doubt, by angelic hosts. Now, there are times when Satan has been known to hinder people, godly people. Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, "We would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us."
Yeah. Uh-huh.
All right, there you are.
Yeah.
This is a premier apostle.
Mm-hmm.
He made several resolves to go to the Thessalonians, who was only had less than a month of exposure. Could be only 3 days, it could have been.
Yeah.
Satan hindered him, but Jesus kept the Thessalonians from falling.
Amen.
Huh? They held to their way.
Yes.
He made them stand, even though the one who converted them was wanting to get there. So see, even when Satan does hinder, it's not total to hinder.
Mm-hmm.
He can't stop God. He can't stop Christ. He can't stop holy angels.
Amen.
Can't stop the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
All he can stop is human activity.
Yeah.
And even there, there's bottlenecks where he's powerless. So what do you have here? The psalmist said, "Delight thyself in the Lord, and you'll have the desires of your heart." That's happening right here in this text.
Amen.
Right here in this text. And when they found Jesus, first thing they said, they made a request that he'd tarry with them.
Yeah.
At the first thing. They didn't wait till they heard it. That's the first thing. Stay here with us. Tarry with us. They were asking him to stay with them. They made a request to be among them for a time. They begged him to stay with them. They begged him to stay in their village. Mm-hmm. Now, those who really want Jesus are not willing to settle for brevity
mm-hmm. yeah.
and infrequency.
Yeah.
They won't settle for this. I worked with a number of people that joined us in Indiana that had been expelled from a fellowship, which I was brought up in myself, because they wanted 2 Bible studies and prayer meetings a week. Oh, yeah. This happened in 1958. And 26 people were expelled, not allowed on the premises of this fellowship. I mean, you know, Dean Bolt, he passed away, he was one of them. Yeah. Ken Mills Paul, he was another one of them. Kenny Smith, he was another one of them. What I'm saying here is that people, wherever revival or renewal breaks out, people are not willing to settle for short periods of assembly.
Amen.
Now, I've been involved in several of these kind of revivals, not as many as I'd like to have been. He abode there 2 days.
Yeah.
Right, now, if you trace through the gospel, you'll be amazed how few extended stays Jesus had any place.
Mm-hmm.
You read a lot about the next day, he goes someplace else. The day following, he goes someplace else. Sometimes he would send the crowd away, but there are very few times Jesus stayed in one place for a period of time. Turn to the Gospels and see. You'll find this is the case. But here, it's because of the people. The people wanted him to stay, so he stayed. Oh, what Jesus can do in 2 days. Oh. If you had 2 days with Jesus, it'd be equivalent to, like, who knows how many years with anybody else. Now, it's my persuasion that a lot of people forfeit available teaching and illuminations from Jesus because they're too anxious to leave.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't make this stuff happen. Understand? You can't just say, "Well, we're going to meet for so many hours." But that's not how it's done. It's got to be some substance.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not for longevity without substance.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Some people, they have longevity. Pretty soon they're talking about baseball and Super Bowl and stuff like this. Pretty soon, see. But I'm not for that.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is, that someone that really is interested in Christ, you'll not be able to limit these kind of people. There's a sort of a thirst that's and a hunger that's awakened in them, but they won't settle for bits and pieces or spiritual hors d'oeuvres.
Yeah. Yeah.
They just won't do it. They'll be easily distracted. As I mentioned to you, I've been involved in several spiritual awakenings. One was in Indiana. I was exposed to one at Notre Dame University. One occurred here. And in these, everything got longer. It's kind of phenomenal. We had meetings in Indiana, men's meetings. I had a job, full-time job. And another fellow and I, many a time we would meet someplace and go straight to work the next morning. This happened a lot of time, not just once in a while. Some other people had the same experience. We've had experience that we were so long, we met so long, some of the people forgot their kids sleeping under the benches. Oh, this happened, didn't it? A lot of time. Maybe it happened to us, even. It wasn't that we were indifferent, it's just that time, you're not conscious of time. The first time in Indiana, we were liberated to sing without being crammed into a box of some kind. We'd sing for an hour. You're just sing, because we hadn't sung all verses of any song. Well, we were discovering songs, so we had long. Why? This is how life is. Spiritual life is this way. You can't measure it. You can't duplicate it. You can't set boundaries for make this happen. You can't make this happen.
Yeah.
But when someone has this genuine interest in the Lord, they may come over, a couple of men may come over to visit. Yeah, they stay till 1 in the morning. Right, Brother Tony?
Yes, sir.
Now, nobody can make this happen.
That's right.
What I'm saying here is that these people, when they asked Jesus to say, it was because they anticipated some benefit, some advantage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Some of them may have been waiting for something like this for a long time.
Yeah.
See, there have been people in the world for a long time.
Yeah.
They've been waiting for something of significance to happen from God. Some people have lived and died, never seen it.
Yeah, right.
Never seen it their entire lifetime. They never saw it. Never saw any significant spiritual awakening, but longed for it. See?
Yeah.
When John the Baptist showed up, this is how there were some people been waiting and waiting and waiting, and nothing had happened. Whole generations had died and nothing had happened.
Yeah.
And along comes this breath of fresh air from heaven.
Amen.
John the Baptist did no miracle. And all of a sudden, these people who'd been waiting, boy, they perked up. Simeon, he's an old man. He'd been waiting.
Yeah.
But when Jesus was born, now he knew salvation had come. Now the thing's underway. Now the thing we've been waiting for is underway. It's going to happen now.
Amen.
So if you set your mind on really wanting something from the Lord, you really want spiritual substance, and you set your desire on it fervently, I'm telling you, God will see to it you get it.
Amen.
It may be in an unexpected place. You may have to go out of your way to get hold of it, but it'll come your way. It'll be available. That's how God is.
Amen.
They that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. Praise the Lord. Now, many more believed on him because of their work. Many more. Now, already it said that many believed because of what the woman said. Now, many more.
Yeah.
I don't know how many quantitatively, how many many was, but it was must have been many.
Yeah.
We're not told what Jesus told them. Right? He doesn't go into what he told, but he no doubt elaborated on what he told the woman. He probably told them too about the gift of God and living water and everlasting life, and he probably elaborated on that for these.
Yeah.
Think how that sounded to these people.
Yeah.
I think there are some people today. I think they're conscientious people, but they've never heard of something that won't deteriorate. Their whole life is lived with an acute awareness of deterioration and depletion and decreasing and growing old, and to just hear about something that's not even in that category. Never goes down, never diminishes, never gets old, but only increases. See, well, that's what these people are hearing about this. And it had awakened a great joy in their heart, no doubt.
Amen.
After they'd heard him, I don't know when they went to the woman to say this, but actually said, but he finally went to the woman. She's never named. Isn't that interesting? We read about Ruth, read about Naomi, read about Mary, Elizabeth, Phoebe. But you never read the name of this woman. But we'll know it someday.
That's right.
Someday, the Savior's going to parade this woman out in glory and say, this is the woman that caused many Samaritans to believe. They said to the woman, they said to the woman. Now, I assume this woman wasn't necessarily popular. But when both of them interested in Jesus, that unpopularity, that dissolves away. She probably wasn't considered close friends of the citizenry there. But when you're centered around Jesus, you don't think about this kind of thing. So they felt free to talk to her. She felt free to talk to them. They said, now.
Yeah.
Now. In other words, read it, it's no longer, henceforth, no more. Now, this is an interesting word, now.
Mm-hmm.
Now. The word from which it's translated, now, has this lexical meaning. No longer, no more, no further. Negating an extension of time beyond a certain point. No longer, no further, no more. The extension of time up to a point, but not beyond, no longer. Now. All right. The word doesn't mean at this present time. That's not what now means. Out of the scripture. Now means whatever was going on before this stops and a new thing started.
Yeah, uh-huh.
That's what now.
Yeah.
That's what now means in scripture. It's a spiritual phenomenon that characterizes truly spiritual life. It's a kind of a line of demarcation before which things were different, after which things are new.
Like a before and after photo.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Uh-huh.
Amen. It's a progressive trait too. It never is used for something that goes backwards.
Mm-hmm.
Retrogression, retardation, diminishing, decreasing. He's never used of that. Only a forward progression. What do you think of the now view? Passing from death to life. Now is when that occurred.
Yeah,
once you were darkness, now you're light in the Lord. See?
Yeah.
Darkness, that's what went before.
Uh-huh.
Now you're light, that's what's now. Now is when it happened. Once you were the servants of sins, now you're the servants of God. Romans 6, 20 through 22. See? Now is what is in between those two states. The new creation is described this way. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. That's what I choose now to call the now factor.
Yeah.
Now everybody in Christ... For everybody in Christ, there's the now factor.
Yes.
There's a point in time when certain things stopped and certain things started.
Amen.
Right? That's a point.
Yeah.
Very specific point.
Uh-huh.
It's a point in time when something became old and all things became new. That happened.
Amen.
There's what point in time when you were not in Christ and then you were in Christ. It all happened in the now. Now, it's my persuasion, brethren, that many professing Christians have never experienced the now factor. They really can't point to a time when it was then and now, or there and then. But when something really does happen to you, and it does, all that is in a direct association with Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Christ is the minister of the now that we're talking about.
Yes.
If you think only in terms of progression, there is progression. Understand, there is progression. But that's not what the now is not about, the progression. It's about when there couldn't be progression. And when there could be progression,
that's
talking about the now.
Yeah.
one manner of life ceasing. See, recovery plans all are saying the old hasn't stopped.
Yeah, that's right.
So what we need is not a procedure. What we need is a new birth.
Yeah,
a now.
Yes.
When something stops by divine power.
That's right.
And something new starts. Yes.
Amen.
Is this now the same word that was used when Jesus said, blessed are those who weep now, blessed are those who are hungry now? Is that
the same
thing?
Yeah,
it's
the same thing, yes.
So how does that?
Well, he was speaking then what was going to happen, because what was going to be the result of his ministry was what was going to take place after that now.
So it has a very much forward.
It's a forward
part.
But
it starts at this moment.
It starts at this moment, but Jesus was introducing what was to come.
Cause and effect.
Yeah, it's involved, I think, yes. Cause and effect is involved, but this is speaking of when it actually starts. So Jesus said this, now you blessed are those that weep now. What he was saying, this is coming to an end. And he was coming to bring in, but they that weep now, you shall rejoice. See, that's It's edifying to think about. If you ponder it, you'll be able to associate with a lot of your own life. Now, we believe. What happened here? They went from faith to faith.
Amen.
Remember that Romans 7:17?
Yes.
He says that just to live by faith.
Yes.
The righteousness which is of God by faith to faith.
Yes.
All right, here's what happened. By faith, that's the faith they had with the testimony of the woman.
Uh-huh.
To faith, that's the deeper.
Yes, amen.
Faith that came from hearing Christ.
Amen.
The believing involves being thoroughly persuaded and convinced. It is not intellectual.
That's right.
Believing is not intellectual.
Uh-huh.
When one believes, doubt is expelled. Questions wither.
Mm-hmm.
When you believe, it's amazing how many questions you stop asking.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you not experienced it? You experienced this. There's some questions you stop asking.
Uh-huh.
Withers. You don't believe with your mind.
Yeah, right.
You believe with your heart.
Amen.
Because this is precisely stated. Romans 10:10. With the heart.
Uh-huh.
See, this is not an activity of the mind.
Uh-huh. Yes.
And some procedures to bring people to Christ are appeals to the mind.
Yes.
The appeal has got to be to the heart. For
yes.
With the heart. That's
yes.
The center part. That's the engine of the man.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That the heart is to man what an engine is to a car.
Yeah.
The heart is to a man what a dynamo is to the generation of electricity. It's the heart center of things. With the heart way down deep. You might say that like the believing that the woman, they believe because of the woman, is like taking the nail and positioning it and giving it a little tap to secure it.
Uh-huh.
Then Jesus is the hammer and he drives it down through the crust of unbelief into the heart.
Amen.
See?
Yeah.
That's what happened when they believed here. That time comes. I can remember when I experienced that. When it went from the head to the heart. You know that Jeremiah said, thy word is like a hammer. Well, it does. It drives it down.
Yes.
Jesus referred to this as his saying, sinking down into your ears. Remember when the Ethiopian eunuch, now I think all Philip did, I don't think Philip told him he had to be baptized,
yeah. Uh-huh.
Even though he should. I think what he told him was that Jesus was baptized. Because
yes.
He preached Christ.
That's right. Yeah.
And when the eunuch hears that Jesus was baptized,
yes.
He says, look, what does hinder me?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Philip said, if you believe with all your heart.
That's right.
Huh? Uh-huh. Right? Romans
yes.
8:37, Acts 8:37. That's what he said. If you believe with all your heart.
Right.
See, how do we know that? Well, you've got to press this upon the person.
Mm-hmm.
And when the person believes it, then that brings Christ and the Holy Spirit and God into the scenario. You've got to depend on God to do the final persuasion, so to speak. You got to give him something to work with, though, see? Give the Lord something.
When this work happens in the person's heart, you won't be able to deny them being baptized.
That's
they
right.
They will demand it.
That's
they
right.
will not be quiet. They will not
yeah.
stop.
They'll command the chariot to stop.
Yeah.
Amen.
To the Lord.
Amen.
He commanded the chariot to stop. They were in the desert, you know.
That's right.
You haven't forgot that, I trust. There was a body of water. What was that body of water? What was that body of water doing in the desert? That's the Lord for you.
Yeah, yeah,
He'll make a way. He'll put a body of water in a desert
yeah.
if that's what's needed.
Amen.
Thank the Lord. We've heard him ourselves.
Yeah.
Oh. What an experience that must have been.
Yeah.
Speaking as a man, I can only imagine how it was to hear this Lord Jesus talk that just exuded confidence. There was no doubt in anything he said, no ifs, ands, and buts or anything like that. Only surety and certainty.
Yeah.
And you sensed that he wanted to tell you, and as much as you wanted, he did you. Just to be in the presence of somebody like that is a great benefit. I suggest that all of us can try to our measure to be this kind of person.
Yeah.
The kind of person that if someone really is in quest of the Lord, they feel in order to ask you to linger a while. See?
Yeah.
Now, this is with some people that they won't, as they are now, they'll never experience something like this. But there's no reason why every child of God can't live close enough to the Lord. There's some people that look like they're so far off, there's no hope for them. Some people, because of you, will make a trip to see Jesus. That's true. You have that much influence when the Lord's with you.
Amen.
We've heard him for ourselves. And the conclusion they came to, this is the Christ, the Savior of the world. All right, now, these people accepted Moses. Moses didn't say boo nor ba about Christ and the Savior of the world. He never said a syllable about the Christ or the Savior of the world. And that's all they received with Moses' writings. So even to know that there was such a thing as the Christ, the Savior of the world, they had to come in contact with some Jews. They are the only people in the entire world. In the entire history of the world that knew about a coming Christ, the Savior of the world. No other people on the face of the earth were ever sent a messenger that had this word.
Yeah. Amen.
From the beginning of time up to Christ came, no other people received this message. John the Baptist didn't preach to the Gentiles. He didn't preach to other nations. He didn't travel to other nations. See? So to get this word, we know that, incidentally, there's no record that there was a synagogue in Samaria either. It's interesting. Macedonia didn't have a synagogue, but most places where the Jews were scattered, there were synagogues, and the Apostle Paul would always go to synagogues, and almost every time there were Gentiles there. Almost every time you read through the book of Acts, there were Gentiles there. They were glad to hear the good news. So I'm assuming that these Samaritans had come in contact somewhere with the Jews and with the synagogue. I don't know how else they'd have known about the Savior of the world. But what a marvelous thing had taken place there.
Yes.
I don't think they realized what had really happened in awakening an expectation of someone who would be a deliverer and a savior. See, there are still people that can't imagine somebody like this. They can only imagine like a despot like Hitler or Stalin or Mussolini or the ISS, and that's the, when they think of a mass influence, this is what they think of these type of people. But God has influencers.
Amen. Yes.
People that can spread the word that'll give people enough to have an anticipation that something's on the way.
Amen.
Yeah. And I think it's our duty to diagnose the times and know the type of times we're living in. But we can't, that can't be our main message.
Uh-huh.
Our main message has got to be something good is coming.
Yeah. Amen.
Now we know ultimately, but all the things that will come before, we have no conceptual idea. But we've got to leave people with that.
Yeah.
Something good's on the way. God has something planned that's going to negate all this stuff.
Amen.
They had got this word. That's the thing. That's the thing that caught my attention. These Samaritans got that and talked about the Christ, the Savior of the world. Based on what they heard him say, they said, this is the one.
Yeah. Amen.
Well, God was in that. Christ was in that.
Yes.
And if you just give the Lord something to work with, he'll do it. Any of you have a word you'd like to say before we move on? Word to Judah.
This now that you're talking about, there's a lot of instances where the word now isn't it's not, you don't see the word now in the text, but it's assumed that you're doing this now. And there's a lot of critical things to Romans 13, the night is far spent, or 13 verse 12. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light.
Yep.
That's now.
That's right.
That's
so
what
now.
We're in the middle of doing. And Jesus is in the middle of our doing it.
That's right.
We don't have to do that alone. So when Jesus says now, get ready to be used by Jesus.
That's right.
Here's another one. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ.
Yeah,
that's what we're doing now.
That's right.
And that's by the grace that Christ gives us. That's how we keep doing that.
Amen.
Now.
Amen.
Anyone else tonight? Brother Tony?
Give the Lord something to work with. Now, she had a testimony.
That's right.
She went back with a testimony. The Lord took that and used it.
That's right.
They came out there because of her testimony. He was able to build on that.
Mm-hmm. Now you know it takes. She concluded that Jesus technically didn't rehearse everything she did, but he said enough that she knew. He knew.
Yeah. I was thinking that too. That what he knew her condition.
That's right.
And she knew he knew her condition, and she knew really she was without hope.
That's right.
And so this testimony gave her hope.
That's right.
And so it also transmitted the same hope to these people. So therefore, there was something to look forward to. Like you said, you got to leave them something to look forward to.
Amen.
Well, God is good, and you've got to be able to. Your testimony should transmit that to people.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think it's good to say that what you talked about this evening and taught about God doing something and something, God doing something good and so forth, is not like Norman Vincent Peale, Robert Schiller, and Joel Osteen.
That's right.
It's not that kind of stuff.
No.
Human religious philosophy. We're talking about divine activity in the human heart that transforms the individual the image of Christ.
That's right.
And brings them from this present world, death, into life, eternal life, forevermore.
Amen.
Life indeed. That's what we're talking about. I'm not talking about something good's going to happen to you today.
Yeah.
Not at all.
Your life may or may not get better. I mean, if you're
a lot of us grew up with those kind of things.
Living in squalor and this sort of thing, of course the things will be better for you, but you're being prepared for eternity. You're not being prepared for now.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right.
And part of your use, part of your usefulness now is God preparing you for the world to come.
Yeah. Yeah. It will affect you now.
Oh, yes, it will. Yes, it will.
Yeah. Yeah, this woman's message, when she went back to him, remember she told him, she said, come see a man,
yeah, man. Mm.
Which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ?
Yeah.
So now this was they had to come, if they were going to come, and examine.
That's right.
And find out what, and then their testimony with the woman, he's the Christ.
That's
this
right.
is what, she was right.
See, there was a coordination.
Yeah.
I don't think I mentioned this. It's in there. I think it's in that lesson. But they took the testimony they received from Jews, Moses and the testimony of this woman, and the words of Christ, and they blended them all together. They were not in, there was no friction between these factors. They were perfectly harmonious. So what you've got to see this. Your word is powerful when it blends with everything else that's powerful.
That's
see,
right.
If you speak a word that is easily contradicted by something God said, just stop saying that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That now factor you brought up, this transitional period where we are changing, it burns me when people forget about that. And they actually are convinced something's happened at all, but something I considered is, what part of why we come to Jesus, when you come to Jesus, you're coming with this desire to change. I mean, that's like what drew you to him in the first place.
That's right.
It is. I mean, like anyone who honestly came to Christ, I mean, that was like a main motivation. I want to be different. I want something different. So it's good to draw people in that state, their attention, like, well, why did you come in the first place?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because you'll find, like, a desire to change, that is what, like, initiated this. So,
if you delight yourself in the Lord, he gives you the desires of your heart.
Yes.
Yeah, Brother Abe?
Going back to her testimony, that is kind of interesting. At first you think he just says one phrase, and she goes back and says, he told me every single thing I did in my whole life. But really, interestingly enough, it's she knew that he knew who she was and loved her anyways.
Yeah,
he gave her that hope, gave her Christ, gave her the truth. And that really is our testimony, is we're junk, and he met us and made us what we were not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she knew from what he said that there wasn't anything about her he didn't know. It was a conclusion, but it was a valid conclusion.
That's right.
So Jesus will reveal enough to you. If you'll listen, you got to listen to him.
That's right.
If so be that you have heard him
and
been taught the truth as it is in Jesus, that's Ephesians 4:12. If you will listen to him, he will convince you of the truth.
Amen.
The only way you'll not get it is to turn your head.
Yes.
That's the only way. And people need to be told that. Listen.
Yes.
Don't turn away. When you feel an awakening in your soul, don't smother that with some kind of activity.
That's right. Yes.
Don't say, well, I got to go now.
Uh-huh.
And people are encouraged to do that because we're living in a time that's filled with distractions. See, this is not the old days when people plowed in the field and come home and ate and went to bed. This isn't that kind of day.
Uh-huh.
They're surrounded by voices that are calling, beckoning people.
Amen.
But the call of Jesus is louder.
Amen.
It's up above. Mm-hmm. But a person has to be sensitive to it. When they do, they'll leave Samaria and go to a well.
Amen. That's right.
A lot of people will. They'll leave Samaria and go to the well. Mm-hmm. On the basis of this, God worked with that testimony.
Amen.
About the people who stopped their buying and selling, closed their businesses, stopped cooking and stopped eating and went outside the city to see this man.
Until that kind of attitude, you can't make this happen, but until that kind of attitude comes, people are not going to get anywhere.
Yeah, that's right.
That's got to happen where you're willing to leave your nets.
Amen.
And once you encounter Jesus, and you feel that inclination, follow it. Yes, Brother.
Amen. I think this woman's testimony is like an example of what Peter was talking about when he said to always be ready to give a reason for the hope that is in you.
Yeah.
Some people, when they hear that, they think what he's talking about is an apologetic, like you're just defending a position.
Yeah.
And then it just becomes an intellectual thing, and the reality of these things tends to escape you at that point.
Yeah.
But that's not what she's doing here. She's talking about realities and things that are driving and compelling her. And she's just telling what God did. And that's what Peter's talking about.
See, one person's heart can communicate with another person's heart, whereas your head or your mind may not be able to do so.
That's right. Now, this testifying, testimony, this is core. And the apostles preaching and teaching, testifying.
That's right.
You know, now Jesus came with a testimony. Faith is calculated to work up with a testimony. Give me a testimony.
Yeah, that's right.
I think about how the woman ran back. Now, she didn't. I don't think she just come casually walking into town. I think she probably had a little. She had a little run to her.
That's right.
She tried. Hey! You know, trying to get everybody's attention.
Amen.
So this all worked for her testimony.
That's right. Yeah.
You overcome, you know, by the word of your testimony.
That's right. Yeah.
Yes, Sister Barb.
I was also thinking about her return trip, because when Jesus was at the well, the Lord drew her out of the city to deal with her and to give her the testimony that she could take. But she took it back into the city before the other men came out to see Jesus.
Amen.
That's right.
So I was considering our testimony. Number one, we're in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, a lot of us have left institutions and religious settings that we need not to be afraid to re-enter if the Lord gives us a testimony for that place so that men can be drawn back out.
Yes, very good.
Amen.
Judah?
I think Brother Jim had something before I
go. Yes, Brother Jim.
It occurred to me that a testimony without the now moment has got to be coerced.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Very good.
And
very good.
Our religious society so much equates behavior that the person who was a drug addict for 30 years, they have a testimony.
Mm.
But I, who grew up in the church, you know, what is my testimony?
Yeah.
I hear that a lot, and it's a coerce. You know, you need to give your testimony.
Uh-huh.
But again, it's the focus on behavior, and it's the focus on what has happened to me, which is the problem with overall, you know, a lot of preaching about man as opposed to preaching about God.
Yeah.
When you had the now moment, and God did his work in you, there's no coercion that has to happen.
That's
because
right.
the testimony that comes out
Amen.
Is God's work. But without that,
that's
this
right.
happened now to me.
Uh-huh.
It just becomes what I'm supposed to do.
That's right.
Another work that I'm supposed to do.
Yeah.
Now we've got examples in Scripture of several proclamations, Book of Acts. There's several of them. To my knowledge, none of them is a declaration of what the person, what happened to the person. Brother Justin.
This is powerful because God is in it. God is working things out. God is the one that's turning the hearts of men. God is the one that used this woman to turn these men's hearts to Him.
Yeah.
It's like when I've been in Daniel this past week, and I was just I had never really considered before how when Daniel spoke to Arioch, the captain of the executioners, he was sent out to just kill all the wise men.
That's right.
And he's an executioner, so he's not like a softy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But when Daniel spoke to him, he just listened.
Yeah.
And God was in that.
Yeah.
God was in that.
That's right.
Yeah. So like when we witness to other people, when we give our testimonies, whatever we do, when we work heartily unto the Lord, we have to be fully convinced that God's in it. God is.
Yeah.
He's using us. He's the one that's behind it.
It shouldn't be necessary to say this, but you never want to exaggerate what you think of God and Christ or what God's done in you. Never exaggerate it, because God will not work with exaggerations.
Amen. Amen. And at the same time, if you're not excited about your testimony, I'm probably not going to be.
Yeah, I probably won't be either.
Yeah.
Judah?
There's a lot of plain declaration going on in this passage. Jesus, the woman says, I know that Messiah cometh, and when he comes, he will tell us all things. And Jesus says, I am he. That's a plain declaration. And then the woman leaves her water pot, goes into the city, and says, is not this the Christ? He told me all things that ever I did. That's a plain declaration. And now, here in our text, the other Samaritans say to the woman, we believe, we've heard him ourselves, this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. That's a plain declaration. I thought of another spot where this is mentioned in Hebrews 11:14. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. Mm-hmm. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the promise. And they're strangers and pilgrims on this earth. This goes in verse 15, if truly they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to return, but they desire a better country. Mm-hmm. The woman came with a water pot to get well, to get water from the well, and she found something better. She found something better, and if she had really been mindful of that water she was coming to get, she might have had a chance to disregard what Jesus was going to tell her and get her water and leave without the testimony of Christ. But that's not what happened. When Jesus plainly reveals himself and declares himself to you, something's going to happen that you didn't know was going to happen.
If you believe it.
Exactly. Yeah. And especially in this case, that's a silent exhortation for us. These died in faith. They didn't receive the promise. We have received the promise. And Christ is that promise that's been plainly declared to us.
Yeah.
And we have that. So if they were seeking a better country, we seek that better country with a promise.
Now see, we've received what they were promised, but see, we've been promised something too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Uh-huh. And I am chagrined is probably a good word. That I don't believe Christian people are telling their children this. You know, the Jews told their children about this coming deliverance.
Yeah.
So a few centuries pass, and the Jews in the bondage in Egypt knew what was coming.
That's right, yeah.
I'm telling you now that in the last 4 or 5 decades, the expectation of a coming Christ has almost passed away.
Yeah.
You don't believe that? You just listen. Do your homework and listen.
Yeah.
You will find when people mention the last days, they're always talking about the Antichrist.
That's right, yes.
Huh? It's almost passed away, so the people are living without hope.
Yeah.
Because if this is not, if you're going to have hope, you have to have a message of hope.
That's right. Amen.
It has more to do than life here and now. Hope has fundamentally to do with then and there. And this has got to be told. Teach your children this so when they're 3, 4, 5 years old, they know about the resurrection of the dead, the coming of Christ, the world to come, and this will happen. We've seen this happen too much to doubt this.
Uh-huh.
They'll know about this.
Yeah, that's right.
And it'll be a contribution that no one will be able to take away from them. If some people haven't heard about these things until they were grown-up adults, and yet they were in the church all their life, and they've never heard a sound exposition of Christ in their entire life.
Yeah.
They've just heard a dabble here and a dabble there. It's enough maybe to get you started, but not to keep you going. And another thing to remember, that this Samaritan woman did not need an apologetic to prove that Jesus was the Christ.
That's
all
right.
She needed was one statement. I am he.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah.
That's faith. See,
that's right. Amen.
Faith doesn't need a whole bunch of evidence.
Amen.
Just needs a clear, concise statement.
Yeah.
And when a statement's made and the people don't believe, he that believeth not shall be damned.
That's right.
That's the way it is.
Testimony.
Pardon?
Sometimes that's the reason for your testimony.
That's right.
Yeah.
So your testimony has to lead in that.
That's right.
In that direction, that this is not just something you found, and now life's better, and life has improved. It's got to be. That's true, but it's got to be more than that. If you want God brought into the scenario, God's looking forward to the heavens and the earth passing away, the resurrection of the dead, the removal of the devil. He's working in view of that. And he wants you to live in view of that. And if you fail to live in view of that, you are handicapped. Just the Christ, the Savior of the world, points in that direction. Well, anyone else tonight? I don't mean to start preaching again here. All right, I think we'll have Sister Barb come forward.